church. And I tell you what, I'm going to
few scriptures here in a minute maybe with you, but we want to just go to the Lord in prayer. And if you're here today, the main thing is, if you don't know the Lord, you need to know him as your Lord and Savior before you get out of here. Now if you already know him, you know what we're going to do? We're just going to join together and worship him and lift him up. And well, she snuck in the back door on me, and she's my help a lot of times, and I thank God for her. But you know, there's a passage of scripture I want to look at, and I'll get her to slide us down there, Marty, to John 15:5. And if you remember what Jesus is talking about there, he's talking about staying connected to the vine. So this morning, if you're not connected to the vine, it's a great day to get connected. Amen. But I love what he said in this fifth verse. And I can't remember if this is message or good news, but we'll figure it out. The left-hand side, I know, is King James, but let's read the right-hand side. He says, I am the vine, you are the branches. Okay, we got any branches in the place? If you're a branch, go ahead and don't be bashful. Just raise your hand. I'm a branch, glory to God. When you're joined with me, I with you, the relation intimate and organic. The harvest is sure to be abundant. Separated, you can't produce a thing. What did King James say? You can bear much fruit, for without me you can do nothing. Now today, I came here, but I can't do nothing. I'm not going to wind your clock. Pastor Mark won't wind your clock. But I'll tell you what, if you'll get hooked up with Jesus, one day he wound my clock, and it was dead, and it wasn't moving. And I found him, or he found me, glory to God. He already knew where I was, but I found him. And I love him today. And I pray you go way different today when you really get. Now, some of you already worried about. I dug around and I went through 2-3 pair of shoes. And I went back to the ones I always wear. They feel good. Don't matter what you're wearing today. You know what? God looks on the heart. He looks on your heart. He don't care much about what you're wearing. Amen. But he knows your heart. And you let me talk long enough, and my heart will tell you what's inside of it. If I listen to you talk, I can figure out what's inside of you. But I pray, my prayer is that you know Jesus when you leave this place. Glory to God. Glory to God. Let's say a short prayer. Amen. Jesus prayed some of the shortest prayers you ever seen. Rise up, be healed, be whole. Amen. And we love him today. Lord, we love you and we thank you, Lord, for this day. You've given us a day that we can worship you in spirit and truth. Now, God, I pray, Lord, that all of us would just relax, including myself. And, Lord, what I don't want to do today, I don't want to miss you. Amen. Lord, we invite you. Lord, you came in with us. You was already here when we got here. You're everywhere. So I ask you to change hearts today. Let somebody be saved today. Somebody encouraged. Somebody lifted up. Somebody that's laying in the hospital. God, you heal that heart, God. Lord, we love you today. Lord, you're good. Your mercy endures forever and ever. In Jesus' name we pray. Glory to God. Thank you, Lord. This one here a lot of times just gets me ready. Amen. The thing that we focus on will be the largest thing we'll see today. So if I make my mind up to focus on Jesus right now, he'll be the biggest thing. I said he'll be the biggest thing, church. Glory to God. Invite him, sing this song. It says, welcome, Holy Spirit. Welcome, Holy Spirit. Fill me with your power. Live inside of me. Sing that again. Welcome, Holy Spirit. Welcome, Holy Spirit. to be here with your presence. Fill me with your power. Live inside of me.
He's the living water, glory.
You're the living water.
Sing it out.
Now let's bring the music real down. I want to hear y'all sing. God wants to hear you sing. Welcome, Holy Spirit. Welcome, Holy Spirit. Fill me with your power.
You're the living water.
You're the living water. Never die found. Comforter and counselor. Take me.
Sing the last
line. Live inside of me. Live inside of me. Amen. He loves you today. Amen. He loves you. You're the best of all his creation. Amen. How'd I know that? Because he gave his son. And I think sometimes, what would I give? Would I give my son for an old rotten world? You see, I'm just messed up. I'm bent on backsliding. I'm to the left. I'm to the right. I'm up and down. But if you read over in Hebrews, he's a God and he changes not. Amen. You can count on God today. Now, if you're looking for a preacher or a church or a people, I hope we are reflections of Jesus Christ. But the one you need to look for today is Jesus Christ. Because he's perfect. Amen. And the Bible will tell you, and it's all truth. We live in a culture where there's not a lot of truth. So it's important for us to be the light and the testimony that we can be, so folks won't go to a devil's hell. Amen. I don't know about you, but... Every now and then I get in some trouble, and you know what I do? I do one of two things. Usually the first one I'm going to tell you about comes first. I just find me a song, and I begin to sing it out to the Lord. And there's just great healing in it. We were talking the other day, me and the wife, and you know, if you 30 minutes a day is heart healthy. And if you sing hymns talking about Jesus, that's even better. Well, that just lines up with the scripture. Why? Because he said, "In a merry heart doeth good like a medicine." And so I found myself many times in the middle of the night. And a lot of times I'll just sing this song that Leon's going to sing. It says, "'Tis so sweet. 'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus."
"'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take Him at His word, just to rest upon His promise, just to know the saith the Lord. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust Him, how I prove Him more and more. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust Him. In Jesus, just to trust His cleansing blood, just in simple faith to plunge beneath the healing cleansing flood. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust Him. Trust in Jesus, just from sin and self to cease, just from Jesus simply take life and rest and joy and peace. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust Him. How I prove Him more and more. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust Him more. I'm so glad I learned to trust Thee, precious Jesus, Savior, friend, and I know that Thou art with me, will be with me to the end. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust Him, how I prove Him.
A cappella, the chorus.
Jesus, Jesus, how I trust Him, how I proved Him more and more. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, oh, for grace to trust Him more.
Sing that last line.
Oh, for grace to trust Him more.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. I believe y'all come to worship today. Amen. We want to do a song now. It's a little bit faster, and when I get down to the end of it, we're going to let you greet one another. And but we're so glad you're here today. And these guys, they get wound up a little bit. And if you, I kid Ed, if you leave him very long, he'll get over an E chord, and you never know what he's playing. And we might have to get it sanctified before we play it today. But this one's a good church song, and so it says, I'm going to praise the Lord. Who's going to help me? Oh, I'm going to praise the Lord. I'm going to praise His name. Oh, I'm going to praise the Lord. I'm not going to be ashamed. Well, the devil won't like it, but I don't care. I'm going to sing about my Jesus everywhere. Sing the chorus again. Oh, I'm going to praise the Lord. I'm going to praise His name. Oh, I'm going to praise the Lord. I'm not going to be ashamed. Well, the devil won't like it, but I don't care. I'm going to sing about my Jesus everywhere. Oh, I'm going to praise the Lord. I'm going to let you greet one another. Come on, good to have you in church. His kingdom has no end. He's closer than mother, father, sister, brother, friend. He gave me a promise if I live like I should. He'll take my circumstances and work for my good. Oh, I'm going to praise the Lord. I'm going to praise His name. Oh, I'm going to praise the Lord. I'm not going to be ashamed. Praise the Lord. give the Lord a hand clap of praise. He's worthy. Amen, amen, and amen. Glory. Hallelujah. I believe some of y'all got woke up. Amen. I hope I woke that old basset hound up across the street. Woo-wee. I couldn't hardly ever get Daddy to go to church. And I'd say something to Daddy. He'd say, well, I can't go today. He said, I'm Catholic. He had a couple barn cats around there. He'd say, I'm Catholic. I can't go. Amen. But I thank God for the Holy Ghost about 6 weeks before he left this world. He gave his heart to God. And you know what? He was just a child of God. He wasn't Assembly of God. He wasn't Catholic. He wasn't Catholic. He wasn't Baptist. One of these days, all the labels is going to blow off. But you better know Jesus. You better have him inside of you. You better have your name written on the Lamb's Book of Life. Glory to God. Woo-wee. Don't you love going to church? I do. It's a highlight of my week. Amen. You can have that wire twisting and pulling and all that and yard mowing and all that junk. My, my, when we come to God's house, it's a good day. Woo. I wanted to do Come and Dine today. We're going to eat after a while. So that ought to make you feel good. Amen. You know Jesus and you're going to eat. Woo. We was trying to figure out how many tables to set up. And I finally looked at brother and I said, don't worry about it. I know how people are. They get hungry. They'll find a 5-gallon bucket or anything to sit down on and eat. Yeah. All right. Well, boy, if we was that hungry for Jesus, we'd be telling the world about him, wouldn't we? My, my. Well, I tell you, I'm glad he's here today. Amen. He's an awesome God. And we're going to sing just a couple more. And we're looking forward to hearing from these ladies today from Priscilla's place. And, boy, isn't God good? Isn't he good? All the time. Sing a little bit of that one. These guys don't know why I was going to do this, but sing it. This says, my God's good. My God's good.
My God's good.
My God is good.
My God is good.
All the time.
All the time.
My God is good.
My God is good.
He's good in the morning. Good in the afternoon. Yeah. Good in the evening. Don't you know? My God is good. My God is good.
My God is good.
My God is good. My God's good.
My God is good.
I like that walking bass. God must like it because he taught that man how to do it. Well, he's good in the morning. Good in the afternoon. Good in the evening. Don't you know? My God is good. My God's good.
My God is good.
My God's good.
My God is good.
All the time.
All the time.
Tell you what, if you got him real running over and full, you just can't hardly help to move. Some of you, I can tell you, just standing there, I don't know if you got mad on the way to church or what, but this would be a good time to get her straightened out or get him straightened out. So just bump him a little bit. Yeah, give him a little bit. Let that Holy Ghost walk. Yeah, man. He's good in the morning, good in the afternoon. Don't you know? My God is good. Now I'm a little still worried about some in. He's good in the morning. Good in the afternoon. Good in the evening, don't you know? My God is good. My God is good.
My God is good.
My God is good. All the time.
All the time.
All the time.
All the time.
My God is good.
My God is good.
Now some of you just about to get hooked up. I saw somebody back here and they were really tearing it up. need it. Amen. I love God's people. You know, that's one of God's, Jesus' motives. Amen. To love people. Number one was to give God all the glory. Amen. Number two was to love people. Amen. Sinners and non-sinners. Amen. But the third one was to recognize evil. Good and bad. Amen. Now, I'm going to do just a little bit of it, more of it, and then we're going to do a worship song, and we'll turn it over to the pastor. Amen. Glory to God. Glory to God. I just like, I like to go out different than the way I come in. You see, the enemy tried to get me distracted. And he might already got you distracted with me, but I'm sorry. But I looked up there and I saw a light bulb out, Pastor Mark. And then I saw a cobweb hanging on that same light bulb. And you got, sometimes you got to reject that stuff. Amen. That's an evil thought. Just cast it down. I know some of you already thinking about them cowboy beans. Fried chicken. Amen. But this is the time of the service where you can really dig in. And I'll sing a little bit. I won't even do that. But sing a little bit of this song with me today. Aren't you glad he's your king today? I love what this song says. It says, I'm forgiven.
I'm forgiven because you were forsaken. I'm accepted. You were in. I'm alive and well. Your spirit is within me. Because you died and rose again.
Think about it, church.
Amazing love, how can it be that you, my King, would die for me? Amazing love, I know it's true. It's my joy to honor you.
You are my king.
Kids sing it sometimes on Wednesday night, and you know, I want to be able to way, I want to worship the way they worship in heaven. And I don't know about you, I've read that last book over there, and we'll sing just a little bit of this one. Jesus, To him, we cry, holy, 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 we cry, holy, 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 we cry, holy, holy, holy is the Lamb.
Thank you, Lord.
We cry, holy, holy, holy. We cry, holy, holy, holy. We cry, holy, holy, holy is the
Let's do it again. I don't know about you. I ain't going anywhere after church. Amen. I got time to worship him today. Not on no clock. Amen. God's not on the clock. Or if he is, he's on a different clock than we are. The clock that I know is he's going to come back soon. And he's going to require each of us to be ready. So anytime during this service, you need to get to the altar and talk to God. You come. Somebody will come behind you and pray with you.
We cry, holy, holy, holy. We cry, holy, holy, holy. We cry.
Church, come on, let's don't get into a big hurry here. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Leon, I believe while I was running around, I believe they were working on some special music. What y'all come up with, Leon? Oh, I love this one. Now, this will tell me my age a little bit. But when I got saved, they were singing this song, and we'd go here, and a lot of times we'd hear groups sing this song. Amen. Amen. I don't know why Jesus would love me or love you, but he does. This song kind of tells it.
Such as I, over shame and such disgrace. On Mount Calvary took my place. Then I ask myself this question, who am I? Who am I that a king would bleed and die for? Who am I that he would pray, not my will, thine for? The answer I may never know, why he ever loved me so. Yet to an old rugged cross he'd go, for who am I?
Well, praise the Lord. How many glad to be in church today? Amen. How many say this is better than being in the hospital, right? Amen. How many say this is better than being in jail? Ask me how I know that. I've been there, done that. Amen. It's not any fun. How many say this is better than being the old dead church downtown where nothing moves except the ivy growing up the walls on the outside? Well, we're glad you're here today. We're glad to have Teen Challenge here today. And I know most of you know this, but I'll just say it for the benefit of some of the girls. I was ordained by David Wilkerson back in 1987 and pastored a church in Toronto, Canada. And we spent a lot of time going to London, Ontario to to Teen Challenge Center up there. So I've had a long relationship with Teen Challenge. I appreciate what they do. And Sister Gwen, just stand up there right there. Amen. This is Sister Gwen. She's kind of in charge of the program at this moment. And we've given her an offering already from the church. But if you want to give an offering and write a check or give some cash, give it to Sister Gwen as you go out today or before you leave or back in there while she's eating chicken. It'll be all right, too. But how should they make that out? Priscilla's Place? Priscilla's Place. If you want to give a little additional offering, that would be great. God bless you. We're going to turn this thing over to Sister Gwen. Just you, just well, stand up, and we're going to let them do their program. Teen Challenge is a wonderful place. It's Bible based, and let me tell you, you can go to all the addiction centers you want, but if you don't end up with Jesus in your heart, you're probably going to fall right back into it when you get out of there. Amen. Jesus is the only one that can change your life and change your heart and change your mind and deliver you. He's a deliverer, amen? And you won't find deliverance anyplace else except in Jesus Christ. Sister Gwen.
Thank you, Pastor. Thank you all so very much for opening up the house and letting us come and sharing what the Lord is doing at Priscilla's Place and what the Lord is doing in our lives. It is not about a specific program. It is about His presence and how He changes lives, amen? So I came to the door, through the door at Priscilla's Place. It'll be 3 years in September. And I came through those doors in a journey of faith. I didn't know where God was leading me, where God was guiding me. I knew after multiple years in corporate that God was doing something new. I just didn't know what the new was. Anybody ever been there? Done that, right? We don't know what it is because it's new. And sometimes we look at it and we go, well, we should know this new thing. Well, it's new. We don't know the new thing. I had left many years of retail, and I didn't know exactly where I was stepping at next. And I went down there. I seen a program manager on Indeed for Teen Challenge. And I remember I was a youth pastor for 7.5 years, and I had taken some teenagers down to the campus many years ago to see what Teen Challenge was about. And when I came across Indeed, I seen program manager for Adult and Teen Challenge. And I called. They invited me down, and I still wasn't sure that this was what I was supposed to do. So I said, well, I'm going to volunteer. I want to volunteer. And it was on a Monday. I was driving into work, and I said, God, this is truly stepping out on faith, because the income was going to look totally different than what I had been used to in providing for my family. And I said, I'm going to need you to like reveal to me. Because anybody ever feel like you've made a mistake and stepped out sometimes and it didn't work out the way you thought? I was a little gun shy. And so I was a little bit nervous about this new thing, because I was like, am I going to make a mistake? Am I sure I'm hearing from you? Anybody have these conversations with the Lord? I'm not alone in this, right? So I'm driving, and there's a little cobblestone alley behind our campus, and you got to go really slow because it'll knock your car out of alignment. Would the girls say amen? Amen. Amen. And so I'm going really slow, and I remember it was dark. I was going in, and I was asking, Lord, I need you to tell me that this is what you want me to do. And I get in there, and it was about 1 o'clock. The volunteers come on this campus every Monday and Friday and have been faithfully for years. And I sat in with their Bible study with them. They had never met me before. And I'm sitting there, and this gentleman goes, it's not by coincidence that you're here. It has been prayers that have been prayed. And I knew right then and there that this was exactly where God had wanted me to serve at. See, when I was 27 years old, I had prayed that God would give me the opportunity to serve full time in His ministry, doing His work. Well, now that I'm 52 years old, God has opened that door when I was coming on the age of 50. So sometimes God speaks a promise to us. Don't grow weary in doing good. Amen. For at the proper time, there is a proper time. Well, I have stepped into that proper time many, many years later to serve the Lord full time for his kingdom. Amen. So I love what the Lord is doing in the lives of the ladies at Priscilla's Place. And now I get the amazing honor and opportunity to serve in his ministry for the women's ministry, and then also on behalf of the men, which is our Chad's Hope. So right now there are three campuses in the Adult and Teen Challenge of Kentucky. One is Priscilla's Place, and you're going to hear about that. It's for women 18 years and older, and Priscilla's Place offers long-term residential care for women who are struggling with addiction or life-controlling issues. Then Chad's Hope, which is in Manchester, Kentucky, is for men that are 18 and older that are struggling with addiction, alcohol, anything that's just wanting to bind you. And then we just opened our third campus April 16th in Meade County, which is Brandenburg Outreach. And that is for women 18 and older, and that is our short-term program. So it's our 5 to 8 weeks. They can finish that, and they can say, I want to do the long-term, because we know life doesn't wreak havoc within 5 to 8 weeks. It takes a long time to get there. Would you all agree? So we pray that God would begin to move on their hearts, and that he would change the direction, and that they would stay and transfer over to Priscilla's Place now to do their long term. So what we're able to do is because of your generosity, because of each of your all's prayers, the amount of women that come through the doors. We are completely donor funded. Completely, everything. And we never want to say no to anyone based on their financial status. So we say yes to everyone. When I'm doing an interview with a young lady who's currently incarcerated, and she would say, I have nothing to go toward my tuition or any of my fees, that's okay. We're still going to open our door and bring you in. That's because of all of you all that pray and support this ministry. I always want to encourage, because Pastor David Wilkerson years ago said yes. Didn't know exactly, God called him to the city, and he said yes. And here we are today, still over 200 campuses in the United States and more worldwide, because one gentleman years ago said yes to God. We get to be in that ripple effect still today. I'm going to bring the ladies on up, if you all will come on up. So what we do, and I like to just kind of frame up, because it's 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. What Adult and Teen Challenge does, it's not just a program. This is a discipleship ministry where we are in the Word of God from the moment that we wake up until we go to bed, because it's the Word of God that renews our mind. Amen. So along with Priscilla's Place and what every one of the ladies that come through our door, this is what you all help us be able to do. We provide housing ongoing, that's utilities, everything that include with that. Ongoing discipleship, case management, peer support, Bible and recovery curriculum. Because we're accredited with Teen Challenge, all of our curriculum comes from Adult and Teen Challenge, and all of our curriculum is rooted in the Word of God. Personal needs, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, staff care. Because we are accredited with Teen Challenge, we have to make sure that there are staff on the campus, either when we're awake or while we sleep. And we also do aftercare planning. What that means is graduation day is very important. Matter of fact, you're going to hear from Tasha. She's getting ready to graduate in September. I'm not going to steal her thunder, though. I'm going to let her talk about that, because she gets on to me for that. It is not just about graduation day. It's very important. It's a special day. But we're looking at that they would have life and have it to its fullest, and it extends beyond graduation day. And that's why that aftercare planning and that sense of community that they feel like they're part of matters, that they have someone to reach out to and call, because we can all agree here in the room that we're all going to come across some tough times, right? And when they leave the walls of Priscilla's Place, I call it a little protective bubble there. I mean, you're just in chapel, you're in the Word, you're being encouraged all the time. We know it's not like that outside those walls. Are we being encouraged 24/7, 7 days a week? We better be doing it on our own, right? As David said, and he encouraged himself in the Lord. But we want to equip them by the word of God to be able to handle when tough times come. So beyond graduation day. So I'm going to call Miss Tasha up. Y'all give her a hand. So here's what I say to everyone. When I was a youth pastor, we had a big screen, kind of like this one, behind. And I would tell everybody, imagine every mistake we ever made in life would show up on the big screen behind me. That'd be kind of scary, wouldn't it? Because we've all had some mess ups. If you've had a mess up in life, will you raise your hand? All right, so we're all in the same place. We can all relate to this. It's not easy getting up in front of a group and sharing your mistakes openly. Would you agree with that? And so I call them our hope stories. See, it's because of Jesus, he changes our lives. He changes everything. And we want to point people to him by sharing our hope stories with you. Amen. So again, I'm going to let Tasha share her story. Will y'all clap for her one more time?
Good morning, everyone. I'm Tasha. And, okay, so I was in darkness for a long time. My daughter had passed away back when I was 27. I'm 34 now. So I was in darkness for about 6 years after that. I just went walking one day and I found a drug house, and I didn't have any foundation, or I didn't know where to turn to. And I got arrested I don't know how many times. I couldn't tell you. And never did I want to get clean. Never did I want to get better. I just basically was killing myself. I didn't have any hope in my life. And but after a while, my soul was so tired. You know, I couldn't. I could barely even put my hair up in a ponytail because I was just so exhausted from life. And so, but the last time that I was in jail, I was in the hole for most of the time. I served a state year, and when I was in the hole with another girl, we couldn't have anything but our beds and our blankets. And but every day she would wake up and she would beg the guards for a Bible. And for over a month, this woman was begging for a Bible. And it got to the point, I'm like, what does she know that I don't know? I mean, the way she was craving and begging for it. So when she finally got a Bible, I just started asking her questions. And I would ask her, you know, when she would go to sleep in the middle of the night, I'd ask her if I could borrow her Bible. And I just started reading. And I started getting a relationship with the Lord. And so he found me right there in my jail cell, and which was so beautiful because, I mean, I did not deserve, you know. And after about a month and a half of reading the Bible, God started making me think about my dad, who he was abusive when I was younger. So I never, after 12 years of not speaking to my dad, that would not have been me that would have wanted to speak with my dad. But I called him, and sure enough, my dad actually had found God as well. And so we both were able to forgive each other for things in the past. And yeah. So I told my dad, I said, Dad, I need somebody to come pick me up when I get out of jail, because I was absolutely terrified of going back to the life that I once knew. And I mean, I was terrified. And he did. He came and picked me up, and he let me stay with him until we found us a rehabilitation center, because I knew I needed to learn how to do life again. And he was calling around to different places, and finally one secular place that he called, he told the person that got on the phone with him, told him, look, if you love your family member, do not send them here. Send them to a Dalton Teen Challenge. So that's how we found out about Adult and Teen Challenge, and my dad found Priscilla's place, and this place has helped save my life. It's helped. I've been able to cultivate a relationship with Jesus Christ, my relationship with my family, and I really love this program. Thank you.
I love you. I'll tell you something funny about Tasha, because when discipleship is really doing life together. So this past week, we had an amazing opportunity to go to Way FM, and you're going to hear starting. Anybody ever listen to Way FM? Way FM? Way FM? No? Okay. Well, September 9th, it's going to start airing. It's a Christian radio station. And Tasha was working on her testimony. They had to be 15 seconds. And she was up at the mic, and she was like, I'd really like to sing my testimony, because she was truly believing that this could be her break into the singing career. So she was really, she kept saying it, I could sing my testimony. And for them to get 15 seconds to be able to communicate how Jesus has changed their life, you know, it's just beautiful. It's an honor to be able to see this, you know, that truly only by the presence of the Lord does transformation happen. Amen. I'm going to bring Miss Jerry up. I'm going to kind of go out of order, surprise them a little bit. So Jerry, there are two ministries within Louisville, because we're in Louisville, downtown Louisville, heart of Highlands. You're going to hear a story about how two ministries work together. We are partners with Hope Rescued, which is Alex and Destiny. And they are out in the streets of downtown Louisville every Monday and every Thursday. And he met Jerry. And then Jerry is now with us. So the power of community within ministries, God uses different people at different times to fulfill his purpose in people's lives. So I'm going to let her share this story with you.
Thank you, Miss Gwen.
Thank you, Miss
Jerry. Tasha. You're always an inspiration to us. Hello, church. Thank you for having us, by the way. My name is Jerry, and I'm 55 years old. I was born May 26, 1969, in Kansas. My childhood was a far cry from normal. My dad was both a chronic alcoholic and a cigarette smoker. He never really worked outside of the house. My mom worked two jobs just to make ends meet. My dad snapped one day and started not only physically, but emotionally and sexually abusing me. With scars that I wore all over my body, I was forced to live indoors without being given a chance to play with the other children around me. Many years went by, and I moved away. I moved out to Nevada, and I lived for a while with a foster family. Considering my growing up years, I wasn't allowed around the other children or even attend school. I faced an obstacle once I got to school that I was ridiculed, I was bullied, and there was a lot of resentment from everyone around me. I ended up going to a Catholic girls' school to finish the 2 years of high school. Once I graduated, I was placed into a halfway house, and I met a guy that was I thought was nice, and he was a little bit older than me. He had a relapse of when he was in Vietnam and physically abused me then. He left me the following morning at a homeless shelter doorstep. There was two choices that I had. I could take a shopping cart or take a ride on a motorcycle. Well, I took the motorcycle ride, and I've been to both oceans, Gulf of Mexico, two of the Great Lakes. I've seen 24 states in my life. And my life was like a roller coaster. I tried to fit in with everyone around me that I thought were decent. Everyone pushed me back, kept picking on me, and afterwards, I've had children in the life. Well, my fifth child was my first son. I discovered that he was different. He was born with a medical condition called hydrocephalus. He lived for 1 year and 2 days. After his funeral, I made the worst decision of my life, to turn away from God. I started to drink wine, and I started to smoke marijuana. That's where I felt accepted. I managed to stop on my own for a very short time. And I had another son. He was born with that same condition. He only lived for 4 months. After scattering his ashes in the Pacific Ocean, I went back to the coping ways. And I tried to stop a few times, but social and mental trauma, the emptiness in your life that can never be filled, relationships that failed, No matter how many empty wine bottles or how much marijuana I smoked, my problems were hidden by that mask. One day, I stared at a map and I wondered where I would end up next. I looked at Louisville. I got off of the bus on December 31st of last year. And in downtown Louisville, I was greeted with the sound of gunfire along with fireworks. The bus station attendant was really nice and let me stay inside the terminal until 6 a.m. So for the next 11 days, I wandered around and I had one of those THC pens and a small bottle of whatever I bought, whatever drink. I walked around a little more and I met up with Hope Rescued right in, out in front of the Salvation Army. The gentleman's name is Alex and he handed me a business card. On January 12th, I threw that THC pen, the alcohol, and the cigarettes that I was smoking into a dumpster, and I called the number on that card. I made the final choice in my life, the choice to turn to God, every part of me, everything. I came to Priscilla's place broken and tired. I was tired. I am now baptized, going on 9 months clean from alcohol and marijuana, and 8 months clean from cigarettes. Once I let God, my Savior, into my heart and into my life, I have become a new creation, a new person filled with purpose, filled with hope, more hope than you could even imagine, ladies and gentlemen. God continues to heal me every single day. Now, we all know the Bible scripture, Philippians 4:13. I can do all this through Christ who gives me strength. And I adopted recently a new Bible verse, 1 Timothy 4:10. That is why we labor and strive, because we have put our hope in the living God who is our Savior to all the people, and especially of those who believe. And I also like to say it, it's a good reminder, the parable of the mustard seed. I wear a mustard seed around my neck to show that I am a child of God. Thank you, church.
Thank you, Miss Jerry. Every morning when I walk in the campus, if Jerry's downstairs, she always, well, they all greet me with such a smile and they make my day. There's such, when you're encountering Christ and things are, there is such a joy that overflows out of our lives, right, to others. So I tell them all the time, they do way more for me than what I could ever do, because the joy that overflows from them, I get caught up in it and it causes me to get excited. Because not only can I share with you what the Lord has done in my life, I can share with people all day long what He is doing in people's life. God is not dead. He is alive, and He is a miracle-working God. He changes lives every day. And when you see it, you can't deny it. I absolutely love to see the work that He's doing and that He will continue. What He has started, He will complete. I'm going to call Miss Nevaeh up. Nevaeh is our youngest on campus, and always I have a soft spot for all of these ladies in a different way, but because I was a youth pastor for 7.5 years, I just love the teenagers, and because if God can come in and intervene in their life now, they won't have to walk through this for 40 years, and I don't want them to have to walk through that for 40 years. The destruction that it causes. Just to share a couple stats, and God is bigger than stats, but I mean, it's mind-blowing. 48.7 million people struggled with addiction in 2023. 310 million people worldwide. Addiction claims 3.6 million lives annually, 10,000 a day, 420 an hour, and 7 every minute. 7 lives are claimed every minute by addiction. 40% of us have lost someone due to addiction. I'm one of the 40. I lost my brother at the age of 27. But there is hope. And that's what Adult and Teen Challenge is all about. Number one, that we can share the message of hope to those that are struggling in addiction. And we can share the message of hope to family and friends of those that are struggling with addiction. Because I see it on both sides. I see what it does to the individual. And then I see what it does to the family and the friends that love the person. When me and Nevaeh had a conversation, she was incarcerated at the time. And we're talking over the phone, and I said to her that when you come here, I want you to feel like you're coming to a home and that you really believe that people genuinely care for you. I didn't want her to feel like she's coming to a treatment facility, nothing wrong with that, a behavioral health facility. I wanted her to feel like she had come to a home. And so I hope that we have kept our commitment to that. Yes. All right. I'm going to let her share.
Hi. I'm 19. I was born and raised in Crossville, Tennessee. And from the time I was born, I don't really think that there's been a point in my life that addiction hasn't affected. I lost my dad to an overdose when I was 4 years old. And I was always in and out of living with my grandmother because my mom struggled with addiction herself. But I got, my grandma got full custody of me when I was 8 years old. And from that point, I was very happy. I was raised to love and trust God, and I loved being with my grandmother. But by the time I was 11, the kids at school began to bully me. They made it clear that I didn't have both parents there at home. I didn't have money like they did, and I was just made very aware of the fact that I was different from everyone else. So that's when I started to kind of resent everybody, and I started to blame everybody for what was going on at school. I started to realize my parents were not there. And at 11 years old, I began to self-harm. By the time I was 12, I was on pills, I was smoking weed, I was drinking alcohol. And a week before my 13th birthday, I overdosed for the first time at school. By 13, I was on probation, state probation, for my first felony charge. And over the next few years, I just stayed in and out of the system. I was on probation for a whole... 6 years. I was just in rehabs. I was in juvenile. I was in behavioral facilities. I was in juvenile prison. I just couldn't seem to stay out of the system. At 16 years old, I began to use meth, and that's when I went back to juvenile prison for the second time. And both of my grandparents passed away while I was in there. So I came home to my brother, and I just continued to use meth, and I just got really downhill. I ended up going back to juvenile prison, and I did a year and 5 months that time. And by the time I came home, I didn't really know anyone my age. I had been gone for so long, and I began to date an older man, and I got back on meth, and then I ended up back in the system. And I aged out there. Somehow I ended up graduating because I really didn't think I would because it was very difficult to stay in school and up to pace with being in and out of the system so much. But I did end up graduating and I aged out on my 18th birthday out of the system. By the time I aged out, I was the first kid in my part of Tennessee who had an ankle monitor in 6 years. I was the first kid who had had a hair follicle drug test. I was really just, everyone looked at me as a lost cause. No one ever expected me to change, and I never expected to change. On my 18th birthday, I came home and I got engaged to my boyfriend. He was an older man. We celebrated by doing methamphetamines, and over the next few months, I just stayed in and out of jail. By the time I had only been 18 for 2 months, I was back in jail for another felony. And I served 30 days for that, and I went out on probation. And then I stayed in and out of jail several times after that. And the relationship with him was very toxic. We were both in and out of jail. He was very abusive, mentally and physically. And he did try to kill me a couple different times. And I was really ready to give up on that relationship, but it was so hard. I didn't know how to go about doing that. But the last time I saw him, I died in his arms. It was the fifth time in my life that I overdosed, and I was pronounced dead on scene. I was dead for a pretty long time, 45 minutes. By the time they got there, they told my mom, they were like, I don't know if she's going to make it. They took me to the hospital and I was not breathing. And they told my mom to come in and say goodbyes, make arrangements. But when she came in the room, I was somehow breathing again. They had no idea how that happened. But then they told my mom that I would be brain dead. Within a couple days, I was in the ICU and I was talking. So they told her, well, she's going to have brain damage if nothing else. But now I do not have brain damage. My mom was praying over me the whole time. But unfortunately, at the time, I couldn't see that was God trying to reach out to me. And I just continued this cycle. I stayed in and out of jail. I got worse on drugs than I was before. And on November 14th of 2023, I went to jail for the last time. I was facing 7 to 9 years in prison. And everyone told me that there was no way, because I was saying, okay, well, I'm going to try to go to rehab instead of go to prison. And everyone was telling me that it was mandatory prison time, that there was no way I was going to be able to go to rehab. But somewhere along the line, while I was in jail, I started reading the Bible, and I found God, and I would pray to God, and I would just beg him for mercy. And I really didn't know what I believed, but I would just say, God, if you're there, just please, please help me. Just, I need help. I didn't want to continue the cycle that I'd been in for so long. And when I did go to court, they agreed for me to go to rehab, which the DA said that it was because something about me just moved in her heart, but I know that was the Holy Spirit. And I've been at Priscilla's place since December 27th of 2023. I've been baptized. I've been baptized by the Holy Spirit. My family just says that I'm a completely different person and I'm more alive than they've ever seen me. And I'm just a completely different girl. And that's all thanks to how God has worked through my life through this program.
So with Nevaeh, I love to worship with Nevaeh, because when Nevaeh worships, there's such, you feel it. And I always share this, because I always say I'm going to get a t-shirt that says, she shared one time, you know, I know what the Lord has done for me, so I worship him like a boss. And I'm like, I love that. But it's true. When you know what the Lord has done for you, your worship looks different. Amen. I mean, it looks different. It sounds different. You know, the Bible says those that have been forgiven much love him much. You can't help but get your praise on. But while these three ladies are staying, I'm going to have Emma come up here really quick, too. So Emma is our program manager right now at Priscilla's Place. Emma also is a 2-year graduate of the ministry, and now she's leadership in the ministry. Again, it's beyond the graduation day. You know, God wants everyone that comes through the door at Priscilla's Place, at Chad's Hope, Brandenburg Outreach, yes, that they have graduation day, but they have life and have life to the fullest, that they would be made whole in him. And to be made whole in him is beyond a graduation day, right? To be whole in him is emotionally, mentally, physically, and spiritually, and that you walk that out for the rest of your life. I'm going to let these ladies get situated. They're going to minister in song today. I always say this because I love humor. You know, I have a joyful heart. My mama had a joyful heart too. But we do sign choir. We don't sing because we would not sound as good as what you all heard today. Trust me, you wouldn't want us on a mic. Look, yeah. Yeah, that's why Tasha didn't get to sing at the radio station when she'd like, I really want to sing my testimony. He didn't take her up on it, but he did say he was so impressed with how well they were prepared to share their testimony. So here's a little exercise for us all. Can you share your testimony, your hope story, in 15 seconds when God gives you the opportunity? Because I do believe God gives each and every one of us an opportunity to share his goodness in the land of the living. Amen? So exercise it. See if you can do it, because I promise you, God will open a door, an opportunity for you to share that testimony with someone else. That's why he's changed us. That's why he's given us a new life, is so that we can point others to him. Will you all worship the Lord with us today as we do Waymaker? Has he made a way for each of you in this house? I know he's made a way for me. He continues to make a way. And so will you worship? I don't want it to be just like a performance. I want it to be to worship the Lord. Will you worship the Lord with us? Amen? All right. It's going to be fine. Y'all just pray for it. Thank you for y'all's patience. No, we're not going to blame it on Brother Kenny. No, not at all. Brother Kenny blessed me this morning with his worship. The whole entire team did. I love a heart of worship. Okay, I think we're getting sound, ladies. Hold on.
You are here. I worship you. I worship you.
Yes. Yes, thank you, Jesus. Good job. Man. Even when we can't see it, even when we can't feel it, he is working. The Bible tells us, he promised us that he does not sleep, nor does he slumber. Even while we sleep, he is working on our behalf. Isn't that amazing to know? You know, I love to share personal things that we can all relate to. I love to share hope and encourage each other in Christ, because we all need to be encouraged. We all need to have hope. Amen. You know, not too long ago, I was sitting on my couch, and I was just sharing this with a friend of mine. We went on a hike Friday morning, just connected about 9 o'clock in the morning, and we just walked for about 3 miles, and I told her the last time I was there and done that walk, I was with my mom, and so I could see in my mind just me still walking with her. We've all experienced loss. We've all lost people that we've loved. And as we were walking, I'm just reminded of God's goodness and his faithfulness. And I was sharing the story with her because she has gone through a hard time lately as well. And I said, one Friday night, I was sitting on my couch by myself, and I was having myself a pity party. I was at home alone, and I was just pouring my heart out to the Lord. And I said to him, is there anybody praying for me? Because I was missing my mom really bad that day. My mom will be gone now, be 3 years this December, and she's my best friend. And I was missing her really bad that day. You ever just have a day where you miss someone really, really bad? And I sat there, and I sat on that couch, me and my dog Pebbles, and I said, is there anyone praying for me? And that Sunday, I went to church, y'all, and the guy that did the transition into offering, he said, he don't know me. He sure don't know the private conversation that I had with Jesus in my living room by myself that day. And he said, somebody's here, somebody, and is wanting to know if anybody's praying for them. And I got a word of encouragement. Jesus himself is at the right hand of the Father interceding for you. Jesus will make himself real to us right on time, right when we need it the most. And I know if he is praying for me when I don't feel like someone's praying for me, guess what? He's praying for every one of you all in this room today as well. Amen. Doesn't matter what mistakes we've made, what situations we may find ourselves in, he's praying for you. He's interceding on your behalf. And he wants to be light in any darkness that you may find yourself in. Amen. I'm going to say a prayer and we're going to get in our word. I never leave a church service without giving the word of God. My word can fail. My opinions don't matter. But his word will never fail and it will never return void. So I take every opportunity I can to share his word with everyone who wants to hear it and sometimes who don't want to hear it. Amen. So Lord, we thank you. Thank you for bringing us into your house today where we can worship you and glorify you and honor you today, Lord. Lord, we thank you for your word. We thank you that your promises are yes and amen. Lord, all that we do today and say today be glorifying unto you. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. So the words that I want to say to you today is let there be light. Let there be light. I was doing a study a couple weeks ago, and it's in Genesis. And how many of us has read Genesis every year? We start it over and we read in Genesis. But the Word of God is active, alive, and it's powerful. And you could read the same scripture every day, but God will speak a new truth to you. So in Genesis 1:3, will you all turn in your Bible or write it down? You can go back to it a little bit later. I'm going to take my glasses off. They're bifocals, so they get me a little bit messed up when I'm trying to see up close with it. I'm reading from the NLT. This is my favorite Bible. Brother Kenny said this morning he loves his comfortable shoes, and it reminded me of my comfortable Bible. I always go back. It is worn and tattered, but my kids will always know that their mama was in this Bible, and my grandkids will know that their nanny was always in this Bible because it is worn, and the pages are worn through. But his word, it is life to all that hear. Amen? So Genesis 1. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The earth was formless and empty, and darkness covered the deep waters. And the Spirit of God was hovering over the surface of the waters. Then God said, let there be light. And there was light. Amen. He said, let there be light. And still today, no matter what we're facing, no matter what darkness that we find ourselves in, the Word of God still rings true today. Let there be light. So I want to take you on through to a couple places in the Word just to bring this all together. You know, I believe in Genesis, and this is just me thinking through. You ever just get in the Word of God and you just begin to think, what did that look like? What did God see when he said that? And you know, because God is all-seeing, all-knowing, he's omnipotent, he's everywhere, right? So I believe at that very moment, he could see beyond just the physical darkness there, but the darkness that would be in the world that we live in, even to this day. And he declared a prophetic that let there be light, and that light would be for us today and even for my grandkids and my great-grandkids until he returns. When you go to Isaiah 9:2, okay, because the Old Testament will prophesy the things to come in the New Testament, amen? So Isaiah 9:2, and I'm just going to bring this home with, let there be light. And I'm going to start with verse 1, Isaiah 9:1. Nevertheless, that time of darkness and despair will not go on forever. The land of Zebulun and Naphtali will be humbled, but there will be a time in the future when Galilee of the Gentiles, which lies along the road that runs between the Jordan and the sea, will be filled with glory. Excuse me. The people who walk in darkness will see a great light. For those who live in a land of deep darkness, a light will shine. So that was in the book of Isaiah, chapter 9. Then if you flip forward to Matthew 4, so the Lord prophesied from the very beginning, let there be light, right? The Isaiah is saying, let there be light. And then in Matthew, light walks in flesh form, amen. So when you get to Matthew 4, verse 16. Well, actually, I'm going to back it up to 12 because he's talking about the same place that Isaiah is talking about. When Jesus heard that John, I'm so sorry, I get fast, I get excited about the word. So let me say where I'm at. Matthew 4. I get excited. I'm like an Energizer bunny with the word. So 4 verse 12. When Jesus heard that John had been arrested, he left Judea and returned to Galilee. Again, in Isaiah, he talked about Galilee. He went first to Nazareth, and he left there and moved to Capernaum beside the Sea of Galilee in the region of Zebulun and Naphtali. This fulfilled what God said through the prophet Isaiah. In the land of Zebulun and Naphtali, beside the sea, beyond the Jordan River, in Galilee, where so many Gentiles live, the people who sit in darkness have seen a great light. And for those who lived in the land where death cast its shadow, a light has shined. Let there be light. No matter what we're facing, no matter what's going on in our nation, no matter what's going on in our city, no matter what's going on in our life, in our family's life at this moment, let there be light. The darkness cannot contain the light. John 8. Taking myself to John 8. Verse 12. Now, a little fun fact about this. When you do a study on the I am statements of Jesus, Jesus always revealed himself as what was going on in the festival time. And so at this time, it was the 16 bowls, gold bowls, that were filled with oil, and they lit them. And he was standing there at this time declaring this. And in John 8, verse 12, Jesus spoke to the people once more and said, I am the light of the world. If you follow me, you won't have to walk in darkness because you will have the light that leads to life. Amen. We will have the light that leads to light. But what's the if statement there? He says, if you what? If you follow me. Lord, give us hearts that hunger for you and follow you. Lord, in the day that we're living in, when so many voices cloud our minds, God, so many opinions, so many different teachings, so many different directions, God, Lord, but your sheep hear your voice and that we follow you. Jesus said that he is the light of the world. He is the light. I'm going to say this again. How many words is it? Let there be light. I'm going to take us back to Isaiah 8 one more time. This is a different verse, but it caught my eye this morning as I was preparing again. And this is 8:20. Isaiah 8, verse 20. He says, look to God's instructions and teachings. People who contradict his word are completely in the dark. To know him is to know his word. To know his word is to know him. Amen. One last scripture. Let there be light. And I'm going to go with John 1:1, and I'm starting there, okay? In the beginning, the Word already existed. The Word was with God, and the Word was God. He existed in the beginning with God. God created everything through him, and nothing was created except through him. The Word gave life to everything that was created, and his life brought light to everyone. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness can never extinguish it. Let there be light. You know, there was a time 3 years ago, I would say I was walking through one of the darkest valleys I have ever walked in. And the Lord shared a scripture with me that ties right into this that I'm going to share with you. And when he first shared it with me, I didn't really understand fully what it meant. But it's Isaiah 50, verse 11. And I lost my second page, but it really talks about be careful when you're walking through a dark valley and you light your own torches. And that's me paraphrasing that. When the scripture is talking about don't find your own forms of salvation, that he is the only salvation that we can find. His way is the only way to get through dark times. So 3 years ago, walking through one of the darkest valleys in my life is when my mom was hospitalized and she was very sick, and everybody was wanting me to make choices. You've got to sign this, you've got to do this, and you got to do this. And literally, have you ever just been so struck with fear that you can become paralyzed and you don't know what to do, right? So I'm going to give you a little humor with it, and then I'm going to hit you with the truth because I love stories and illustrations. Me and my sister was at the hospital together, and they're saying my mom is not going to make it through the night. Now, my mom did make it through that night. My sister does not do well with very stressful situations, and she is panicking full on. Like, I wanted to go movie mode and slap her. You know how when someone's, like, flipping their lid and you just have to haul them right across the face and slap some sense into them, right? So we're out in the hospital aisleway, and she is losing her ever-loving mind out there, okay? And I am the only one now that is to make any decisions whatsoever. And they were going to have to go in and put chest tubes in, and they wanted me to give consent. And I didn't even know the extent of all this. And we're out there, and it's just, you ever just feel like you're in this whirlwind, and man, you're just trying to find something to anchor onto, right? And she's crying. She's asking me, what do we do? What do we do? And I just told her, I said, I need you to get over there in that corner and just start praying in the Holy Ghost, because I need you to go over there. When you don't know what to do, pray in the Spirit of God. That has been my lesson learned in the toughest times, because there will be light in the darkness in those moments. When you begin to pray in the Holy Spirit, the Lord begins to intercede. You pray the things that need to be prayed, because on our own flesh, come on, leave it up to our own demise. It's a horrible situation, right? We stood out there in the hallway. She's praying, I'm praying. And my sister passes out. Like, she gets herself so, I can't make this stuff up. I hope she don't ever watch this, okay? I'm telling it all. She passes out. And because we're Pentecostal, my cousin was there. She could easily just go ahead and catch her, because we're Pentecostal, so we're kind of used to that. We've seen the knees buckle. And she swooped in. And she gets up and she goes, what happened? I said, well, you're just out here causing a spectacle of yourself. You're going to pass out here on the floor. All the nurses had to come out here and tend to you. And we got mom needing a chest tube in there. And it is, God always brings light into dark situations. And so today, you all, that was a very hard time for me. Matter of fact, every time I walked through the hospital to go see her, I truly hung on to that scripture that, Lord, the light cannot be covered by darkness. It cannot. You're going to bring a way. Just like the lady said today, way maker, when I don't see it, when I don't feel it. If you find yourself in a tough situation where you feel like the darkness of it all is so heavy, I pray that in your heart and in your mind, you hear the words, let there be light. And there was, right? And he says he doesn't change. He's the same today as he was yesterday, right? Did my mom go on and meet her maker in heaven? Yes, she did. Do I wish that I still had mama today? Yeah, but I wouldn't bring her back. You know, when you go through the darkest times in your life, that's when you encounter him the most. That's when he shows you who he is in those moments. You know, I once heard, you don't become an expert sailor in calm seas, right? You got to have some tough, rocky waves to become an expert sailor, right? I wish it wasn't so that we only encounter him in his fullest is in the toughest times of our life. But he will not leave us there. He will not forget us. He will not abandon us. And he surely will not reject us. So for us in the room today, maybe you find that you're in a dark situation right now. It could be financial. It could be that the family's getting into it. I have a big family, and sometimes I'm like, what is happening over there? And I have to say all the time, blessed are those who are peacemakers. Come on, get it together. But we're family, and no family's perfect, right? But everybody is going through something. Maybe you're here today, and you're struggling with addiction. Because I believe it's everywhere. But so is the light, amen? And sometimes we got to let light expose darkness and let the Savior have his way in that situation, amen? Can I bring the ladies, will you all come up? Because I'm going to, Pastor, I'm going to open us up with prayer. Do you mind? Ladies, I'm going to have you all come up. That means you too, Emma. And Emma's like, oh, yeah, Miss Gwen. Every one of us up here, God has brought us through and is still bringing us through some dark times. He has been our light. So maybe you're here today. And Pastor, if you have anybody on your prayer team that wants to come up and pray, I want to open the, can I just open us up in some prayer this morning? I want to first say thank you all so much for your hearts toward us. Thank you for loving us and praying for us and accepting that we've made messes in our life, but God has transformed that mess into something beautiful, because that's what he does. He brings beauty from the ashes. Amen. And so in here today, if you're in a tough situation and it feels very dark and hopeless at this time, I'm going to open it up for prayer today, that you can come up. We're going to pray with you. If you're here today and you're struggling with a life-controlling issue, and it can come in so many different forms, y'all. You don't have to be bound by that. You can begin to experience the freedom of the Lord. I'm going to share two great examples. We talk about deliverance all the time at Priscilla's Place. I do believe that deliverance can happen suddenly, and I do believe deliverance sometimes can take some time. And I use these two examples. If I had a splinter in my finger and that splinter got removed, guess what? That healing happens pretty quick, right? If my arm got mangled up and I had severe wounds from the top of my shoulder to my wrist, I believe that that healing's going to take some time to really get that limb to function again. But do you know that Jesus is patient and he is loving and he is kind? So if we have wounds that need to be healed, he is okay to take his time with each and every one of us. So if you're here today and you need healing from a wound, these altars are open. There's nothing to be ashamed of. I ask for healing every day of my life. Every day of my life. The last 3 days, the Lord has told me, you know, he says, I correct those that I love. Lord, let me get it right. And he had said, you've been troubled and anxious over many things, but you have forgotten the one thing. You know, when you get up in the morning, you hit the ground running. Anybody ever just have those moments where you hit the ground running, and then you take those worries and those anxieties and those troubles running right along with you? Well, if you're here today and you find yourself in a place where you're troubled, you have a lot of worries, and you got some anxiousness going on, can we pray with you today? Can we pray? Everybody bow their head. Lord, we thank you for your goodness. We thank you for your faithfulness, God. We thank you for your unfailing love. And Lord, we never want to miss an opportunity, God, to extend your grace, your love, your forgiveness in who you are, Jesus Christ. If you're here today and you have never accepted Christ as your Savior, that's why we're here. That's the number one thing. That's the number one thing. We're never promised another day. And if you're here today and you don't know him as your Lord and Savior, and you don't know him as light, you don't know him as deliverer, you don't know him as friend who loves at all times, today is your day. While no one's looking around, if that's you, will you just slip your hand up? Thank you, Lord, that all of us are in good stand, in a good place. We know you as our Lord and Savior. And I'm going to open these altars today. If you're here and you know someone who is struggling with addiction, would you come and pray? Let's lift up their name unto the Lord together. We're going to leave these altars open for anybody struggling with addiction. It may not be you, it may be a family friend, a family or friend. Or if you just need some hope and encouragement today, we're going to leave these altars open. Thank you, Pastor.
Why don't you stand to your feet? Amen. Maybe you know somebody that's got a drug problem or an alcohol problem, or could be something completely different than that. Come and stand in for them and let these girls pray for you. I know some of you have some of those issues in your life. I want to speak to those on the internet that are listening right now. God's offering you light if you're in darkness. And I want us to just say a prayer of salvation. If you're listening on the internet, God will save you today. If you say this prayer, if you mean it in your heart, just repeat this after me. Dear Lord Jesus, I'm a sinner, and I want to get saved. I believe you're the Son of God. I believe you died for my sins. I ask you to come into my heart, change my life, and make me a new creation. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, if you said that prayer, whether you're listening on the internet or whether you're in this room, just let us know. If you're listening on the internet, God bless you. Till next week.